Hey everyone, this is Rahul Mahajan. Today I'm going to talk about deep learning network architectures. Why specifically this topic? Nothing very specific, though I would like to speak on many other topics on deep learning, but and then eventually have more active collaboration, me participating and learning from many other experts out there. While I have been working on few assignments, one observation that I had was that people need more clarity on network architectures and fundamentals around it. Good thing about deep learning community is that's very vocal. There's a lot of active knowledge sharing which is happening, which is good in a lot of ways. It acts as a catalyst, and people can learn and actively start with something, demo things around. But writing production quality stuff takes a lot more, there's a lot more detail required in writing a good production quality stuff. And that's where it comes to boils down to one's understanding the network architecture, tweaking certain parameters, choosing the right combination of what layers have to go in, and so many other details. So I thought, let's start with this as a topic, and eventually we'll talk more on other topics as we go forward. So let's quickly get started on this one. What I plan to do in the next few minutes is talk about different kinds of image analysis categories, go deeper into convolution neural nets, cover on the different hyperparameters, what are the different choices we have. Go a little deep into MNIST because that's the initial one and that's where some of the fundamentals gets clear. And we'll also talk about real world network architecture, AlexNet, in this video. To get started, image analytics from a deep learning point of view is very broad. It has a lot of categories. All the way starting from classification neural networks, which are typically gonna help us identify whether the object in the image is object A or object B. In this example, whether there is a yellow bus or there is probably a motorcycle or some other object in the image. Popular networks to solve that is convolutional neural network. That's the architecture. The other category of deep neural networks are the ones which are for the purpose of localization. Localization is not just identifying whether in the image the object is object A or object B, but also tells you where in the image that object is. So if in the bigger image, that's the background, and probably in the center the yellow bus is there, and that's the bounding box to isolate where the bus is. Regional convolution neural networks and many other network architectures are again popular to do this kind of problem. Object detection is again a very popular use case in a given video or in a given series of images. Identify where the object is, whether the object is object A or object B. There could be multiple of such objects, so there could be multiple vehicles in a given image. Identify all of those vehicles, create a bounding box on all of those vehicles. Again, architectures to do this could be single shot detector, SSDs. YOLO is another very popular one. There are variations to each of these depending on what type of use case. Any of the variations may work best for you. Let's go take a pause and probably just look at for an image, are there ways to do things differently? If every time the input is gonna be an image or an image frame, are there things we can simplify in neural networks? So convolution neural networks is where we do some of the simplifications. So one of the simplifications we do in convolution neural networks is we don't look at every pixel when we compare an image to classify it. We in a given image, for example, if you're looking at a face, in the forehead, two pixels may not have very different contrast, but two pixels which are quite far may have a different contrast because of the shadows, light shadows, eyebrows with the skin color, eyelids with the skin color, and all that stuff. So if you're gonna scan every neuron to look out for a pattern, that may not be the best thing when you're looking at an image. You must skip certain things. So that's one of the simplification called convolution neural network stuff. Second, obviously, is we don't have to tell the network in terms of how many features are enough for us to solve a given use image analysis use case. And then again, how do you scan an image can be is done in a specific way in convolution neural network. So you in this example, this is an image 32 by 32. A real world image could be much bigger. A full HD image, for example, could be 1920 width, 1080 height, and three channels, red, green, and blue. So for simplification purpose, we have right now taken a 32 by 32 square image with three channels. Next step is to take a patch out of this image. And then as part of the training, look for this patch in all the positive images and configure weights. So take out a patch. So this could be a patch. A patch could be of a given size, a 3x3 patch, a 5x5 patch. Then compare, scan it across the entire image. So the way you run this patch could be in a row major format. So imagine this to be a 32x32 matrix. For example, this is a matrix, 7x7 matrix with three channels, RGB. These are different filters. Again, each filter has similar number of channels. This is one such patch. This is second such patch. Each patch has three channels. You take a patch, you now run it sequentially in this way in an image. When the row finishes, you go to a next row and again run the patch throughout different columns in that row. When that sliding is finished, move to the next row. So imagine this is an image. So you scan it like in a sliding window, left to right, go to the next row, again left to right, go to the next row, left to right. So it's a kind of a sliding window. And for every such operation, you create an output. So in this case, 3x3 filter on a 7x7 image. So when you run a 3x3 window on this image, every time you do a matrix multiplication, you get an output and you write it on one matrix. So for every such filter, you will get one matrix. If you have n number of such filters, as in this example, you can see two such filters, you will get two such outputs. Each of these outputs can be stacked one behind the other to give a volume kind of feel from a visual perspective. So that's how it looks. There are more things which happens after convolution. So let's take an example, another example. This is a 4x4 image. That's the 4x4 image. Within the red rectangle, we want to run a convolution with a 3x3 filter over this image. Now, when you slide, there are certain concepts that one should remember. When you slide this filter in sequential way from left to right and then to the next row and then again left to right, the motion resolution, how many cells you skip, is nothing but stride. So we take a stride of one, which means we we go one cell to another from left to right in left to right operation. And then padding may be required just to make sure on the left, on the right, on the top, at the bottom, certain padding may be required just to make sure the fill, when you run a filter, if filter does not evenly divides the image in terms of number of width pixels, you may want to have certain extra pixels so that there is no spillover. So in this case, we have taken a padding of one, which means one extra column on the left, one extra column on the right, one extra column on the in the top, one extra column in the bottom, which means as you can see, left and right, top and bottom, padding of one on a 4x4 image. So height is 4, width is 4, which means W is 4, H is 4, and we get a 6x6 matrix because of the padding reason. Now when you run a filter and n such filters, in this example it could be, in this example it is 3x3 filter, you will get a certain output. Now again, what is gonna be the size of output? When I work with people in my team, there's a lot of times they don't understand some of these things. So let's spend a little bit time. It's a very simple thing. So if you're running a 3x3 filter on a 4x4 image with a padding of one, which means you have 6 pixels on the width. So if you run a 3x3, you can try to run it once, and then you can see the, what the formula for the output image would be with a stride of one, which means you are hopping one pixel every time. So a simple formula is for width, the resulting matrix's width would be initial input matrix width plus 2 times of padding, because one on the left, one on the right. So that's the overall width minus the filter size divided by stride plus 1. So in this case, 4x4, 4 plus 2 minus 4 plus 2, which makes it 6, 6 minus filter size, which is 3, makes it 3, 3 plus 1 makes it 4. So we have a 4x4 output. Another kind of layer which is generally used in convolution is padding layer. Advantage of having a padding layer is to reduce the size of the matrix. You don't want to continue a big matrix all the way till the end in a series of layers. Idea is to reduce the number of pixels, but you can have more filters in every such iteration. So, right, so convolution pooling. Pooling layer generally helps you reduce the size of the matrix and simplifying the overall computation needs in the architecture. So we have talked about convolution, we have talked about pooling layer. In a typical architecture, we have many more such layers. We have dropout layer, just to avoid overfitting, we try experimenting with randomly dropping certain neurons and still seeing the expectations are being met from the network. Then there are batch normalization layer. At the end of the, we have fully connected layers for activation. There are activation layers which, and then there are various options in activation layer. We are going to talk a little bit more about this. So in general, there are a lot of hyperparameters to be configured. As you can see in this example itself, we have to make a choice on what's the filter size you have to take. Does a 3x3 patch or a 5x5 patch makes more sense? What is the stride? Does it makes to have a smooth sliding, or can we assume to skip certain pixels and have a filter getting applied here, then skip it by 2 and then directly apply it here, which is stride of 2 or 3. So that's the other option we have. How much padding do we want to make at the left, right, top and bottom, just to make sure filter evenly cuts across the width of the image? What's the activation function we need to choose? How many filters do we want to choose at different layers? So there are so many hyperparameters that needs to be configured for a good network to be designed. Let's go deep and spend a little bit time on the activation option, because this is again an area of active research, and a lot of options are available. In a typical neuron, there's an input. In our case of convolution, this could be an output from the input image with a filter that goes into, that gets multiplied with a weight. Then again, multiple such inputs can come. Then there is an aggregation that happens on the weighted times input of every such operation. We add a bias to it. Ultimately, we want an output, whether the next layer needs to see this is an activated neuron or this should be a neuron with zero. So is there enough input for this neuron to emit one? That's what activation is all about. This is a typically a nonlinear problem, given that a nonlinear function works very well with multiple hidden layers stacking together, and then differentiability for backward propagation to work. So there are multiple nonlinear functions to look at an activation. So imagine, so these are a few of the activation options we have. These are the common ones. Sigmoid is the one where for a given X, which is the X axis and Y axis. So for a given X, after a certain level of input, you will see an activation. Similarly, there's a Tanh function, which instead of ranging from 0 to 1, ranges from minus 1 to plus 1. Problem with both of these is they're generally good, but as we have learned more about these activation function, ReLU has appeared to be a better choice. Problem with sigmoid and Tanh is, as you can see, if higher the x, which is this, or lower the x, the slope will go slowly, and the slope progression will happen slow, which means the gradient descent learning will slow down, which is not good. It's gonna take a lot of computation because of that. But ReLU works pretty well in these cases. So ReLU has appeared to be, and then there are variations of ReLU which will not go into leaky ReLU and exponential LU. But in general, ReLU works quite well and is mostly what we'll end up using in our cells. I'll show you an example of this. How did this work in my case? So before we go there, just let's look at the MNIST example. MNIST is a data set of numbers, these kind of images. The problem is to identify for a given written number whether this is identify which number is this in the range of 0 to 9. And these numbers could be written in a variety of formats. 5 could be written this way, a little bit diagonally. And so there are various variations of it. So this is the most simplest Hello World type of convolution network. So let's look at this. Typically, the input size in this data set is 28 by 28 matrix. That's typically good for neural networks. Smaller the dimensions, less number of input pixels, input vector size you need. We take this as an input. Again, this is grayed out, so there are no RGB. So just 28 by 28 vector. We take a patch. In this case, again, as I said, we have an option of taking a 3x3 patch, a 5x5 patch. In this case, a 5x5 patch has been taken, and we take 10 such patches. For every such patch, when it crawls from left to right to the next row, again left to right to the next row, we get one matrix as an output of size 24 by 24. And given that we have 10 such filters, for every such filter, we get a matrix. So we get a 24 by 24 into 10 matrices as an output of this operation. We apply a pooling layer of 2 by 2. Reducing the size of this by half, which makes it 12 by 12. Again, 10 such layers. We then again apply a convolution with a patch of 5 by 5 and 20 such patches. Now we get a matrix of 8 by 8 with a depth of 20. So as you see, from left to right, so all the way starting from input to the output, the matrix dimension is going down because of pooling. The matrix depths are increasing because number of filters are we are increasing the number of filters, and that's a general pattern because as we go deeper into the layers, we want to identify as many as features with a smaller matrix as an input. So let's also look at activation a little bit deeper. How did my activation, different activations work for this kind of model? So what I did was a very simple exercise. I took a sigmoid of 3x3 and a sigmoid with a filter of 5x4 as an activation. I also compared that with a ReLU activation function and a filter of 3x3 and a ReLU activation function with a filter of 5x5. And what I wanted to see how these perform. So what you see on the x-axis is the number of iterations. What you see on the y-axis is the time in seconds. And as you can see, the brown one, the green one, which are ReLU, worked pretty fast because again, the vanishing gradient descent problem is very less in comparison to sigmoid, and hence it works pretty fast. The other test I did was for accuracy. X-axis is again number of iterations. Y-axis is again Y-axis is again the accuracy is from 0 to 1. 1 means we have achieved 100% accuracy. You can see the yellow line and black lines are doing much, much better, and they reach high accuracy with less number of iterations. Again, they are ReLU 3x3 and 5x5. So in general, ReLU works well. And again, filters you can try to configure of different sizes depending on what use case you have. Let's look at a real world example, because real world example will have a full HD image, very complex set of features. Back in 2014-15, a paper got published by Jeffrey Hinton from Google, Alex and Leah from Toronto University, UToronto. And what they did was they took the input image, which was of 224 by 224, and then they designed series of layers, pooling, convolution, pooling, convolution, with different sizes of filter. The sequence is well documented, and what I want to take a little bit time to see how these matrices sizes change with the given input filters. So I'll go back. Let me show you an example. Right. So as you can see, the input size is 227 by 227, which is height and width, and 3 channels. So input layer dimension, which is column B, is true size of 227. Filter is 11 by 11. So I've taken. And there are 96 such filters. In this case, we have taken a stride of 4 because this is the first layer and we can afford to skip certain pixels just to speed up the entire thing. So what's going to be the output? The output, as you if you remember, the formula is very simple. So you take the width, width plus twice the number of padding, minus the size of filter, which is 11, divided by your stride, which is 4, plus 1, which gives you 55 in this case. So 55 becomes the input for the next layer. For the next layer, again, as per the AlexNet specification, we take a filter of size 3x3, 96 such filters, stride of 2. So as you see, the stride, as we go down, is going... is decreasing, which means we don't want to skip more pixels as we go deeper into hidden layers. The number of the filter sizes are also decreasing, which means we want to take smaller filters. We do pool it to reduce the size of matrices. So we are reducing it every now and then. So 227, 55, as you can see, the size of the matrices are going down dramatically. But the number of filters are increasing. So we started with 96 filters in the first layer all the way to 256 in the last layers. So typically when you create your own network, some of the things to watch for would be there is no the depth of filters is increasing gradually. The filter sizes, the patches that you're taking, they should be going down smoothly in subsequent layers. So these are some of the things to watch for when you design or review a typical neural network. So I think just to summarize what we looked at convolution neural networks. We looked at different network layers, convolution, pooling. Then we looked at different kinds of hyperparameters, which are what stride to take, what filter to take, what's the size of filter, how many such filters, what activation function to choose, and so on. And as you can see here also, the number of hyperparameters are in millions at every such layers. So we need to be very careful while we design some of these architectures. What combinations are we choosing so that this whole thing is manageable? So I hope all of this was useful. Do like the video in case you find it useful. And I would try to cover some of the other topics like Google way of doing the same problem, which is inception, and many more other topics in coming time. Thank you for now.